How we are recording, okay? And are there any questions or concerns or anything you'd like to say? Okay, if not, let's begin with edge colorings. So towards the end of the last lecture, we briefly went through edge colorings. We had already seen that before. So an edge coloring is proper if whenever you have two adjacent edges, they get distinct colors, right? And if you have an edge coloring, then the you can view it as a partition of the edge set where each part is basically a matching. So we are talking about proper edge colorings. I will try to say proper edge coloring, but generally, even if I say edge coloring, I mean proper edge coloring. I might just forget to say proper, okay? So if you need clarification, please ask me. Okay, cool. And the edge chromatic number is the minimum K for which the graph is K edge colorable, right? Okay, so then let's discuss. Can we get some easy lower bound on the edge chromatic number? Give me a second. I need a cloth, otherwise, my hand is going to interfere. Give me a second. Sorry. Okay. So, also, if at any point the connection is poor or there are some issues, please send me a WhatsApp message as well so that I can fix things. Okay. So, the first question I want to ask is what is an easy lower bound? On chi prime of G, the edge chromatic number of a graph. Anyone? Can you give me
Delta of
one
G.
delta? Exactly, right? So it is the maximum degree of a graph, because clearly, if you have a vertex with a certain degree, let's say 5, then all of these edges require different colors, right? So you need at least 5 colors. And that gives you the lower bound delta of G. Okay, that's good. So in other words, chi prime of G is at least delta of G. Give me a second, I need to be interrupted. Yeah, please. Yes, she has taken all the morning medicines. Yes, thank you. Hello? Sorry. Okay, so we know that the chromatic edge chromatic number is at least the maximum degree of the graph, right? Good. So then the question arises, what about upper bounds? And I don't know if you have already seen this result in MA2130. Maybe you have seen the result but not the proof. So turns out Wissing's theorem states that the for any graph G, for any simple graph G, the edge chromatic number is at most the maximum degree plus one. So there are essentially two possibilities. Either it is the maximum degree, or it is the maximum degree plus one. Okay. All right. Any questions or concerns? So we will see a proof of Wissing's theorem. Definitely not today. My approach is going to be to first tell you about all the important results and some consequences, and then start proving these results. And as I said, we will be using bipartite matchings to prove the important results in this edge colorings part of the course. Okay, good. So then, well, you might ask, what about multigraphs? So I actually did not know much about the literature on multigraphs with edge colorings. So it turns out that this result, Wissing's theorem, does not hold for multigraphs. Just let me give you a simple example. Right, so here you have a graph with six edges. The maximum degree is 4. How many colors do you need? Can anyone tell me how many colors are required to color this graph, or the edges of this graph properly?
Six.
Exactly. Any two edges are adjacent with each other, so they all must get distinct colors. And so you need six colors. Yeah. Give me a second.
Kuch chahiye kya? Kuch wahan pe rakha hoga table pe. Aur mujhe nahi pata.
Hello. Sorry. So you need six colors, right? Great. So then you might ask, well, is there an analog of Wissing's theorem for multigraphs? Okay. And so Wissing himself proved that there is indeed an analog of his theorem to multigraphs. What you need to do is you need to look at the multiplicity of each adjacency, or each edge, if you like. So for any two vertices UV, you look at the number of edges that join U to V, okay? And you take the maximum over all pairs. That is the multiplicity of the graph, the maximum multiplicity. And instead of one, you replace it by the maximum multiplicity of the graph. Okay, so let's say mu of U comma V is the number of edges joining U and V, okay, where U is not equal to V. And the mu of the graph G is basically the max of these values over all pairs. Okay, so in this example, give me 1 second.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Okay, sure. I'll let you know. Right now, everything is okay. I'm teaching. Can you come at 11 or after that? Okay. Nahi relative. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you. Hello. Sorry, it's the first day, so there are some more disturbances. Okay. So that's the multiplicity of the graph. This is the maximum multiplicity of G. And Wissing's theorem, the generalization to multigraphs, is that chi prime of G is at most delta G plus mu of G. Okay, and now if you apply this to the example we had, the mu of G was 2. And now you see that the bound is satisfied. Okay. All right. So let me put down the numbers of these theorems. This is theorem 17.5, again due to Wissing. And the one we will focus on is Wissing's theorem, in fact. That's theorem 17.4. Okay. And this was proved by Wissing in 64, and also independently by Gupta in 66. Okay. All right. Any questions or concerns so far? I'm actually impressed with the internet connection. I was expecting there to be more hiccups due to the connection. All right. So that's an interesting result, right? That the chromatic, the edge chromatic number is exactly one of two values. Right? That means that based on these two values, you can classify all simple graphs into two classes. And then you could ask the obvious theoretical CS motivated question, how do you recognize whether a graph belongs to one of these classes or not, right? So let me just, right, so in the case of simple graphs, you can classify them either the chromatic number is exactly the max degree or it is exactly one more, right? And these graphs are called class one graphs. Why not? For the lack of a better name. And these are class two, of course. And what about the decision problem? This is one of my favorite NP hard problems, deciding whether a graph belongs to class one or it belongs to class two is an NP hard problem. Okay, so for those who may not have much background in theoretical CS, you don't expect there to be an efficient algorithm to decide whether a graph belongs to class one or it belongs to class two, unless the famous conjecture P not equals NP is false. Okay, so fact, because we will not be proving this in the course, is that deciding whether a simple graph G belongs to class one or class two is NP hard. This was proved independently by two folks, Hollier in 81, and also by Levin and Galil in 83. Okay. So no efficient algorithm unless P equals NP. Okay. So I don't know. I was very flabbergasted, if I may, when I heard that this was an NP hard problem, just deciding between these two values. All right. Any questions or concerns? Okay, if not, give me a second.
Yeah. Abhi theek hai, I'm teaching till 11. Can you come after that, please? Nahi koi allergies nahi hai. Okay, thank you very much.
Hello. Sorry, I think I should be muting my mic when I do these things, but anyways, doesn't matter. Okay. So then, of course, there are some natural questions. Are there some sufficient or necessary? Because you don't expect necessary and sufficient conditions for deciding whether a graph is in class one or class two, right? At least not computable conditions. So you can just ask, are there any either sufficient or necessary conditions for a simple graph to belong to class 1 or class 2. So I won't discuss these in detail. I will just tell you some of the main things that either we will be proving in the lectures, or maybe some of these might be on the assignment. Okay. So let me remind you. Okay, let me ask you, is there a result we have already seen in this course which tells us that a particular class of graphs belongs to class 1? You may have to use the four color theorem. Okay, so assuming that the four color theorem is true, can you think of a class of graphs that we know belongs to class 1? Anyone? Okay, I'll give you a hint. Planar graphs, not all planar graphs, Anand. Can you refine that? Not all planar graphs are in class 1. You need more conditions. With degree less than 5. Is that true? I'm not too sure about that. It might be true. I don't know of that result. What we did prove, assuming the four color theorem in this course, is that three connected cubic planar graphs are in fact three edge colorable, right? We proved Tate's theorem, which says that if the four color theorem is true, then every three connected cubic planar graph is three edge colorable. So by Tate's theorem and the four color theorem, three connected cubic planar graphs, in fact, you may replace three connected by two edge connected. So graphs that do not have a cut edge. This is exercise 17.1.5 in the text. I don't know, I might put in one of the assignments, I'm not sure. Okay. Two edge connected suffices. Okay, so that's the only such result we have seen so far. Turns out that all bipartite graphs belong to class 1, which is kind of satisfying, right? You expect bipartite graphs to be more well-behaved than other graphs. So turns out theorem 17.2 that we will be proving soon, maybe in the next lecture, all bipartite graphs belong to class 1. All of these belong to class 1. Okay. Turns out there are some other, there is one more nice result that I haven't seen the proof of. If your vertices of maximum degree, they induce a forest, which means if you just look at these vertices and the edges joining them, there are no cycles in the graph. It turns out, again, the graphs are in class 1. Okay? So vertices of degree delta induce a forest. So if this condition is true, then any such graph belongs to class 1. Okay? Good. So we will prove this one. Okay. I won't discuss any conditions for class 2. they are a bit cumbersome to explain. You can find some in the exercises in Bondi Murthy. Okay. All right. So before we move on to proving theorem 17.2, which says that all bipartite graphs belong to class one. Okay, so there is a question. Ravi has asked a question. Is it true if the vertices of degree delta induce a bipartite graph? Great question. I do not know the answer to the question. So, yeah. Maybe take one of the examples. Maybe take one of the class two graphs that is given in the text and see if you can construct from that a counterexample to your potential conjecture. And if not, then I would do some literature survey and see if there is any such result out there. But that's definitely a very good question. Intuitively, one would like to think that maybe this is true. Maybe it's not cycles. Maybe it's really odd cycles that are the problem. Okay. So I don't have anything else to say. Thanks, Ravi. Okay. So good. So before we start proving any of the main results in edge colorings, I want to talk about yet another very fascinating topic related to the same class one, class two dichotomy. Okay, so that is called snarks. These are these beautiful graphs, beautiful and very mysterious. Okay, so so notice that if G is any cubic graph, so you don't actually even need simple here. I won't go into the details, but if you like, you can think about simple graphs. Okay, for any cubic graph, the chromatic number is either 3 or it is 4, right? Clear? So just to remind you, cubic as in 3 regular. Okay, so this itself, so clearly, if your graph has degree less than, if the maximum degree is less than 3, then your graph is just paths or cycles or disjoint unions of paths and cycles, right? Those are very easy. You can look at the graph and decide what the chromatic index is. So the point where the problem actually becomes interesting is when your maximum degree is at least 3, okay? And in fact, you could ask specifically for all graphs where all the vertices of degree 3, cubic graphs, these graphs turn out to play a very special role in graph theory. We have already seen before. One example is Tate's theorem, right? So the four-color theorem can be reduced to the study of cubic graphs. Just one example. Another example is the cycle double cover conjecture, although we did not discuss why. But even for the cycle double cover conjecture, you don't need to worry about all graphs. You just need to look at the cubic graphs, okay? So for a variety of reasons, cubic graphs are really important. And in the case of cubic graphs, you can again talk about this distinction, class one, class two. So the cubic graphs of class two are generally, loosely speaking, I'll make that precise in some time, they are called snarks. Okay, because for many results in graph theory, including, for example, the cycle double cover conjecture, you don't even need to worry about all cubic graphs. You just need to worry about the snarks. If you just prove the cycle double cover conjecture for snarks, you will have proved it for all graphs in the world. Okay, so there are these other results which we are not proving. I might put some of these facts on the assignment. Any guesses on what is the smallest snark in the world? What is the smallest cubic graph whose edges require four colors in order to be properly edge colored. It's not a difficult question. Think of the famous graphs. Anyone?
Peterson?
Any guesses on what? Yeah, exactly. It is indeed the Peterson graph. Okay. So you can try to check that the Peterson graph does not have three disjoint perfect matchings. In other words, it is not three edge colorable. Okay. Good. So I'll just state a fact here. It suffices to establish the cycle double cover conjecture for snarks. Okay, good. Just to give you a little bit more information on why they are called snarks. So this name was given by Descartes. I don't know how you say it. I'm pretty sure my pronunciation is not the best. And it was inspired by the poem of Lewis Carroll, also the author of Alice in Wonderland, The Hunting of the Snark, because these are particularly elusive graphs, and understanding them better would vastly improve our understanding of graph theory. And till date, the understanding of snarks is really lacking. Okay. Good. What else do I want to tell you? So for a long time, people did not know how to construct snarks. They knew some sporadic examples, and maybe people had reasons to believe that there were finitely many of them. However, this was disproved by Isaacs in 1975. He constructed infinite families of snarks. Of course, if there were a finite number of infinite families that we could understand, then we could prove a lot of results in graph theory. However, that also does not seem to be true. As you keep on going higher and higher in the number of vertices, you find snarks that are completely mysterious and that do not belong to any of the infinite families that we have discovered so far, or that graph theorists have discovered so far. Okay, so they are really elusive and mysterious graphs. Okay. Good. There is one final thing I want to tell you. Actually, there are maybe two things I want to tell you about snarks before we go on to other stuff. Okay. So there is a conjecture of Tutte from 1966. So before I tell you the conjecture, let's go back to this fact. The smallest snark is the Peterson graph, right? Just to give you an analogy behind Tutte's conjecture, remember the smallest non-planar graphs are K5 and K33, and neither contains the other as a minor or as a subdivision, okay? So these are the smallest non-planar graphs. And it turns out, Krutowski's theorem, that every non-planar graph contains one of these two as a minor or as a subdivision. Okay? So this is the same spirit in which Tutte proposed his conjecture. Every snark contains the Peterson graph as a minor. Okay? Every snark contains the Peterson graph. As A minor. Notice that this conjecture of Tutte would imply the four-color theorem. It is actually stronger than the four-color theorem. This implies the four-color theorem. Why? Because it means that every snark, because the Peterson graph is non-planar, it would mean that every snark is non-planar, which would mean that if your graph is planar, then it is not a snark. Therefore, it is three-edge colorable, right? And that implies the four-color theorem by Tate's theorem, right? So using Tate's theorem, we know that this is going to imply the four-color theorem. In fact, it is stronger than the four-color theorem because the four-color theorem does not imply the result, the conjecture of Tutte, okay? Another interesting fact about this conjecture is that a proof was announced by, I won't write down the whole names, Robertson, Sanders, Seymour, and Thomas in 1997. This proof till date remains unpublished because it is humongous. In fact, Yeah, so it's unpublished, but the proof has been announced, right? Okay. Just to give you some idea about the proof, it's basically similar to the proof of the four-color theorem. I mean, of course, I haven't read the proof. It's humongous. I would need to dedicate 10 years of my life to do that, I think. But they use similar techniques, and it boils down to analyzing some 600 or more cases. And in the end, you basically resort to a computer to analyze all those cases, right? So you have to do computations. So there is no humanly readable proof in some sense. Okay. All right. Are there any questions or concerns regarding all of this? Okay, if not, I want to go back to this statement that I made here. I said that these graphs, loosely speaking, are called snarks, right? What do I mean by this? Can I make it more precise? I would like to. So it turns out that you can impose an additional condition on the definition of a snark, right? So what is the definition of a snark? Just to remind you, it's a cubic graph, G, such that the chromatic edge chromatic number of the graph is equal to 4. In other words, it is not equal to 3, right? But there is one small issue. If you have a snark, let's draw the Peterson graph. If you have some snark, what you could do is you can actually construct a bigger snark from this one by replacing a vertex by a triangle, for example. Okay. And it turns out that this will give you yet another snark. Okay, but in some sense, this is not really very helpful. What I mean is that you don't need to really understand this graph very well if you just understand the Peterson graph. So it's not just about replacing by triangles. There is a slightly more general condition, which is like an edge connectivity condition. So formally speaking, this is actually not going to be a snark. We are going to impose an additional condition. And maybe I will put some question on the assignment where you see why this condition is imposed. But I'll say a few words about it without getting into too many details. So turns out that there's something more general. Observe that these three edges, this is a three cut of the graph. Right? Of course, in a cubic graph, if you look at any vertex, there are three edges, and this is also a three cut of the graph. This is a trivial three cut. However, this here is a non-trivial three cut. What do I mean by trivial and non-trivial? Just to remind you, in case you have forgotten. An edge cut is non-trivial if both of these sides have at least two vertices. Okay? A cut partial x is non-trivial if x and x bar are both at least two. Okay? So clearly, cubic graphs are going to have trivial cuts. Every vertex gives you a trivial three cut. But there are cubic graphs that do not have any non-trivial three cuts. One example is the Peterson graph. Okay? So this condition is called essentially four edge connected. Okay, so what do I mean by essentially four edge connected? A cubic graph is essentially four edge connected if it is devoid of non-trivial three cuts. Okay? So some examples are the Peterson graph. Another nice example is called the pentagonal prism. So it's like the Peterson graph, but not really. This graph also does not have any non-trivial three cuts. And of course, there are infinitely many examples. So in the formal definition of a snark, typically you include this last condition as well. Okay? Because everything I said earlier actually holds for this formal definition. In other words, it suffices to establish the cycle double cover conjecture for this more strict definition of snarks. So you don't need to worry about snarks that have non-trivial three cuts. You can just focus on the snarks that do not have non-trivial three cuts. Okay? Anyways, I don't want to say much more about essentially four edge connected graphs right now. I might put some stuff on the assignment, and I also wanted to make sure that I give you the technically correct definition of a snark and not just the loose definition. Okay? Good. All right. Are there any questions at this point? Okay. If not, I think I'm going to keep the lecture a bit short today. I will just tell you what we are going to do in the next two or three lectures for the rest of this week. And maybe after that, we will have a short discussion about how to handle the logistics of this week and the next week. So this week, we will prove theorem 17.2, which says that for a bipartite graph, the edge chromatic number is the max degree. And we will prove Wissing's theorem. Okay, I won't write it down. You already know what it is. Okay, so this is going to be our main focus for the rest of this module. Once we prove these, we will move on to the next module, whose entire focus is going to be matchings, especially on non-bipartite graphs, since so far we have been looking at bipartite matchings. Okay? All right. Are there any questions or concerns regarding anything we have discussed today? So please stay back for a bit. I want to have a discussion regarding the logistics of this week. All right, so if there are no technical questions or concerns, let me stop recording.